Okay, today we're talking about Chapter 3, Section 3, Graph of Basic Functions, as well as Piecewise Functions. Alright, now this last one, the Piecewise Functions that we're going to talk about. I've said this many times before, when I was in school, when I took this course, rather. When I took this course, I was not going for mathematics. And so I was, you know, just trying to get through the class, hoping that, you know, I can pass everything, right? You know, C's, get degrees. I was a horrible student. But for things like piecewise defined functions, whenever I would get to that, I would think, oh, great, this is dumb. I just hope there's not a lot of these on the test. And there always were, right? And I would just get them wrong because I didn't put forth the effort to even try to learn them. And so I did horrible. I did very poorly, all right? So I want to kind of instill in you guys, don't do that. They are actually super duper easy once you understand their behavior. Okay. But anyways, graphs of basic functions as well as piecewise functions. Okay. So today what we're going to do is we're going to talk about, I think, maybe 9 graphs that have got to be memorized 100%. Okay. The first one is the constant function. The constant function is of the form f of x is equal to b, right? Just, you know, some function is equal to some number. You know, it could be f of x, you know, if we wanted to talk about maybe this, like f of x equal to 2, okay? But it's just some number. It's just a constant function. Yeah, we're talking about nine functions today. All right. So not only do you need to memorize what the function is, you know, algebraically, but we need to memorize what they are graphically. Okay, there's 9 of these. You have got to memorize all 9. All right, you will not succeed beyond this point if you don't memorize all 9 of these. So, and to give you a reason why, right? Because we're going to be talking about transformations soon, maybe in the next course or the next class rather. Okay, and so what we're going to do is, you know, in the past you might have some function f of x is equal to, you know, x minus 3 quantity squared plus 9. In the past, we would make an x, y table like this. You know, if we plugged in a 0, well, 0 minus 3 is negative 3, negative 3 squared is 9, and 9 plus 9 is 18. Okay, and so we would plot the point, well, that's not an 8 at all, is it? So we would plot the point 0, 18. Right? And then we'd do that for all of them. Well, now, okay, we're in college algebra. We're a step above this now, okay? So now what we're going to do is we're going to be able to look at a function like this and say, okay, so this, the parent function, is a quadratic equation, okay? Well, looking at this number where it's located and this number where it's located, I can tell you that we will be taking that graph, shifting it right 3 units, and shifting it up 9 units, and then we're done, okay? We're going to be able to look at functions and be able to tell you, you know, exactly how it's graphed with transformations. So you must know what these, and I call these parent functions, what these parent functions are. Okay, this is the parent function for a constant function. Okay. And I guess to really drive the point home, this, well, I guess I have to point there, this entire function here, the parent function would be the x squared or the quadratic. So that would be the constant function. Next up we have the identity function. All right, so the identity function is just simply f of x is equal to x. Okay? Or in other words, you know, because again we've said in the past, f of x and y, they are interchangeable, right? So this identity function is just basically y is equal to x. Okay, it's just a line that goes diagonal straight through the graph. Okay, it is an important graph actually, not only for our transformations, but also because we will talk about the identity function a little bit when we start talking about inverse functions. Lots of function talk we got going on. All right, so maybe I'll just do 2 per page. We'll do that. Next up, we have the square function. I'm not sure if I got everything there. Yeah. Try that again. Wasn't even on the wrong page. Yeah, I was on the wrong page anyways. So, the square function. Of course, this is like the example I just gave you, right? So, the square function is f of x is equal to x squared. Pretty easy. And, of course, we know that as a parabola, look, that looks like this. Cube function. Maybe I can fit four of these on a page. These seem pretty small. Okay, so the cube function looks like this, right? And well, if you can memorize these two, well, you need to memorize them all, but get intimately familiar with these two, then it'll also serve you well for whenever we get to, I don't know if we get to multiplicities or not, and in behavior in college algebra, but definitely in pre-calculus. We talk about those two quite often. All right, I'm going to come back to the absolute value because I want to go to the square root, and I'm going to put the square root under the x squared. Like this. Although the numbers kind of mess it up, doesn't it? Whatever. We'll live. So the square root function, we see that, you know, f of x equals the square root of x. And we see that we have a graph that starts here. Well, let's see. Maybe we can put the arrow here. That starts here at 0, 0, right? And it goes all the way to the right. All right, that makes sense, though, because, you know, if I put a negative number in there, well, it wouldn't work, right? Negative 4, the square root of negative 4, does not appear on the real number line. Next up, we have the cube root. Okay. So the cube root, right? Notice how the cube function, right? The cube function up here, you know, we are shooting down and then we are shooting up. Okay, well, the cube root function, this top part kind of looks like the square root function over here, doesn't it? Okay, so keep that in mind. And of course, same, well, I won't say same, but similar to the cube function, we also just jet off into oblivion like this, into the abyss. Okay, so I try to put those one on top of the other. Mainly, I guess, for the cube, because I get a lot of issues with students kind of confusing cube function and cube root function, but those would be the differences there. All right, so let's go back to absolute value. Okay, so the absolute value function, f of x is equal to the absolute value of x. All right, so notice how it is a V shape, okay? Mainly because, again, if we had the absolute value of, you know, 3. What's the absolute value of 3? Well, that is 3. What is the absolute value of negative 3? Well, that is also 3. So, you know, we can kind of, you know, because, you know, obviously they don't have tick marks here, but we kind of imagine this being a 3 and this being a 3. And notice how they both cross, definitely not there. They both cross about right here, right? And so it just behaves like you would expect it to if we were to graph something that for the absolute value. We don't use this too often, but again, it still needs to be memorized, and this would be the reciprocal function. So the reciprocal function is simply 1 over x, and you would imagine that, you know, we cannot put a 0 in for x, and notice how, you know, we have a vertical asymptote here at 0, because, you know, obviously it cannot exist. And of course, this would just be our reciprocal function. And lastly, the greatest integer function. And real quickly, the notation, I don't know if you can really see it. The notation here, all right, is kind of like two brackets. Like that, okay? So that is the greatest integer function. Now the greatest integer function does need a little bit of explaining, but not too much. All right, so if I have the, and you know, we can choose any number. Let's see, where's my eraser? We can choose any number. But the text uses two examples here. If we want the greatest integer of 3.001, well, what you're gonna do is you're gonna ask yourself, okay, so what is the greatest integer that we see? Okay, well, that would obviously be 3, right? We're actually going to 3. That is the greatest integer that is available to us. Whereas here, 2.99999999. Now we can stop at 3 nines, all right? 2.999. Well, what is the greatest integer that we pass on the graph at 2.999? Well, that would be 2, okay? Because we haven't actually gotten to 3 yet. So that's how the greatest integer function works. And I don't guess I have to do any more explaining than that. I think that's pretty well put. Okay, these 9, right? I know I sped through them, but you know, again, I record the lecture. You can go back and look at it, as well as I post the notes. But they have got to be memorized 100%. Don't think that you can skim by without memorizing these. Okay, so, excuse me. The domain of the square function f of x is equal to x squared is all real numbers, negative infinity to positive infinity. However, suppose that we were only interested in sketching the portion of the graph of f of x equals x squared for positive values of x. In other words, suppose that we wanted to restrict the domain of f of x is equal to x squared to only the values of x that are strictly greater than 0. The function sketched below on the right is an example of a function with a restricted domain. When we define functions with restricted domains, we typically define the domain using inequalities. The restricted function on the right below is defined as f of x is equal to x squared for x greater than 0. Okay, so what this is saying is, now we're going to start to manipulate the graphs of our functions by manipulating the algebra of the functions. Okay, so this is our normal parent function x squared. Okay, well, if I were to write x squared, then that's what we would do. That's what it would look like. However, if we took that same graph and we restricted the domain to x greater than 0, well then, all we're going to really do is just look at the graph at all the values where x is greater than 0. And that's really it. Okay, but we restricted the domain. We pretty much said, okay, we don't care about any values that are less than or equal to 0. Okay, only the values that are strictly greater than 0. And then we can draw it like that. Right? We're starting to manipulate the way graphs look, again, by manipulating the algebra. Maybe here's an example of why we would, you know, in a real-world example. I don't know if I've given you this example before, but we're going to use it again anyways, if it is, because I know that if I have, it's been a while. Okay, so suppose I build a toy rocket. Okay, I build a toy rocket, and actually let's pin it up a little bit up here. I build a toy rocket, and its trajectory looks something like this. Okay, now of course with this, you know, being the ground, right? And the function, right, we're not gonna have an exact function. We're just gonna call it alpha, a better alpha than that. We're just gonna call it alpha. Okay. Well, if I were to graph the function alpha just by itself, okay, it would look more in line with something like this. Okay. And hopefully you can see. Maybe I should, just in case you can't see that the line's a little bit thicker. Let's change the color. It would look more in line with something like that. Okay? Well, that's why I need to restrict the domain. I need to say, okay, so my rocket's trajectory follows the function f of x equal to alpha, okay? But only for values of x between, and you know, we'll say this is a. Let's call that a. Okay, so we would say we would restrict this domain from the values that are from 0 that are less than or equal to a. I'm sorry. Yeah. No, that's actually about it. Let's do that. That are less than or equal to x. Sorry, which is less than or equal to a. I got a little confused there. Sorry about that. Okay, so I'm defining the domain of this function, and it. The x value must be between 0 and a, okay? And that way we can say, okay, so this is more precise, a more precise way to measure the trajectory of my rocket, as opposed to saying, you know, down here, we are halfway to China, which is obviously not the case, okay? So that's why we need to restrict the domain, because sometimes whenever we graph things, it just doesn't make sense unless we restrict the domain. All right, so this is just reading, sketch the function f of x equal to the absolute value of x for x greater than or equal to 1, okay? So we're going to draw a plane here like this, and we are going to graph my parent function, okay? My parent function, if you can see here, is the absolute value of x. Now the absolute value of x looks something like this, okay? And now we're also going to be restricting the domain for the values that are greater than or equal to 1. Okay, that's what this is saying. We need to restrict the domain for values that are greater than or equal to 1, right? So you know, if this is 1, you know, here, you know, the square root of 1 is 1. About right here. So all we're going to do here is we're just going to erase, and that was obviously, I don't know why I thought I could do that exact, right? All right, let's start that over. Boom, boom, there we go. All right, so if we had a 1 value, you know, we would erase everything below 1, okay? But it isn't greater than or equal to, so we know that we can make this a closed circle. And that's it. And as always, I'm going to give you the nice pretty graph, even though, guys, my graph is really good. That is a phenomenal graph, especially that blue line. So you guys are very lucky to have somebody that can draw graphs just splendidly like that. Make sure you put that in your review. Okay, so next up we've got, we got down here, new page. Okay, so we need to define a function given a graph. Okay, so you need to be able to spot what function, what a parent function might be looking at the graph. Okay, at first thought, you should think that this is an absolute value graph, right? Because if we didn't restrict the domain, it looks like it's making a hard V there, right? But then we'd restrict the domain. Okay, so what we're going to do is now we need to write the domain of the function using interval notation. Okay, so the domain of the function, okay, the domain is where all the x values, okay, again, all the x value, where on this line will I see a graph? So it looks like from negative 2 to a positive 1, a graph exists on that plane. So we would write negative 2, okay, we're going to put a parentheses there, right, because this is an open circle. So from negative 2 to a positive 1, and we're going to put a bracket because this is a closed circle, okay? And that would be the domain of this function. B wants us to define the function using an inequality inequality two. Inequality to express the restricted restricted domain. Okay, so here's how we do this. Okay, so we're gonna put B. So similar to my rocket that I showed, right? I'm gonna write my parent function, and I know I wrote alpha, but so I guess that's not a good example now, is it? But anyways, we'll start here. My parent function here, we said, was an absolute value equation. Okay, so we're gonna say f of x is equal to the absolute value of x. Okay, that's the first step, right? Well, where does this exist? And let's actually, we might need a little bit of space. All right, we're not gonna need all this space, but I didn't want to be crammed up against the wall over there. Okay, so we have the absolute value of x, or f of x equal to absolute value of x, okay, for the values of x being from negative 2, okay, and it is it's an open circle, so we're going to put a less than, right? So x is going to be between negative 2 and 1. And that's it. All right, so we define the function using inequality to express the restricted we define the function using an inequality to express the restricted domain. Okay, and again, it explicitly asks us to use an inequality, and of course, this would be our inequality, right? That's how we do that. Okay, so. Okay, we'll do this. I guess we're getting into piecewise now. All right, so starting here, we're going to consider the graphs below of the restricted function y is equal to negative x for x is less than 0 and y is equal to x for x greater than or equal to 0. Okay, so it says that y is equal to negative x for x less than 0. Well, if you recall, this is kind of, I mean, it is, y is equal to negative x, okay, and then, you know, we'll say plus b, okay. And if you recall, this is just my slope-intercept form, okay? And of course, it doesn't have a b, right? So it's just y is equal to negative x. So the graph on the right, I'm sorry, the left, is just a graph of a line with a slope of negative 1, okay? And the other side of that, we have a graph over here with a slope of 1, y is equal to x. Looking here now. If we combine the two functions from the previous page on the same Cartesian plane, we get the following graph, which is the exact same graph as the absolute value function. Okay, so if we took these two graphs right here and we combine them, we got the absolute value function. The absolute value function can therefore be defined by a rule that has two different pieces. We can define the absolute value function as f of x is equal to the absolute value of x, which is equal to x for all values that are greater than or equal to 0, and negative x for all values that are less than 0. Okay? Functions defined by a rule that has more than one piece are called piecewise defined functions. Now, let's see. Okay. Before I lose you on piecewise defined functions, and again, you might not have the same lazy brain I did, okay? But just in case you did, or do rather, piecewise defined functions are super easy, and here's how. Okay, so first of all, have you ever had your teacher, professor, or, you know, I guess those are all options, huh? Give you a test, you know, or a quiz, okay? And they're like, okay, so this quiz has 10 questions on it. And you're thinking, okay, great, 10 questions, I can do that, no problem, right? But on that 10-question quiz, they each have like three parts, right? For like number one, you have A, B, C. For two, you have A, B. For three, you have A, B, C, D, E, and F, right? I mean, yeah, I guess that's a 10 question quiz, but we're really stretching the line there, aren't we? That's kind of what piecewise defined functions are. Okay, they are one function, okay, but they're kind of cheating here, and really giving you two. That's what piecewise defined functions are. Okay, and the way we look at them is we just look at them like we would solve, you know, that quote 10 question quiz. You know, we'd go A, B, C, D. That's what we're going to do here. We're just going to go A, B, C. In this particular case, we're just going to go A, B. But again, that's the thought process. So let's get us a graph. Plane. I always say graph, I know. But let's get us a plane going. Okay. And the first thing we're going to do is we're going to how can I do this to make it look really cool? Let's see, I go. Okay, so here's what we're gonna do. Oh shoot. Okay. Oh no, I did that wrong. I didn't do it the way I want. So let me try that again. Sorry, I'm doing this for dramatic purposes here. I guess I could have kept that. There. Okay, so here's the dramatic purposes. In the red, we have x squared, okay? That would just be the parent function, x squared, right? And in the blue would be my function, 1 minus x. And of course, we can think of that as not only 1 minus x, we can think of that as, you know, if we go back to our slope-intercept form, we could say negative x plus 1, okay? So notice how my y-intercept is at, let's see if I do that. Yeah, we can do that. Notice how my y-intercept is right here about at 1, right here, okay? And I have that slope of negative 1, right? So notice how that line slopes down, negative 1, right? But the main point of this is to look at my domains there, okay? So if we were to look at x squared, we see that we have to restrict the values for all the values that are less than 1, okay? Ah, shoot, I should have done that one first, okay. So notice how here I have all the values that are indeed less than 1, so I'm gonna put an open circle there, okay? And then my blue line is for all the values that are greater than or equal to 1. So we would put an open circle there, okay? And that's it. That's a piecewise defined function. You just basically erase everything that isn't a part of it, right? So all this, you know, was not less than 1, so we got rid of it. All of this was not greater than or equal to 1, so we got rid of it. All right, and that's it. Whenever you graph them, you're going to look at the parent function there, and you're going to look at the domain, and then you're going to graph it. That's the red line. And then we're going to look at the function and then the domain and graph it there. Once again, though, I feel like I made a very pretty graph, but we will still give you the more exact one. Oh, here we go. Now this looks like a monster. All right. I probably should have snipped the problems too, huh? Let's see. Okay, so excuse me. Let's start with A. I don't think we actually have a graph for this one. Okay, so we're just gonna have to go on my pretty graphing skills here. So A, evaluate f of negative 3, f of negative 1, and f of 2. Okay, so here's how we do this. Starting with f of negative 3. What you're gonna do is you're going to look at just this column here. Okay? And you'll ask yourself, okay, so f of negative 3. Well, which one of these lines does negative 3 exist? Okay? Well, negative 3 is indeed less than negative 1, so it's going to exist on this first row here. Okay? So I would plug in negative 3 into that function. Well, it's just a 1. Okay? So I'm just going to put a 1 there. Okay, so next up, f of negative 1. Okay, so f of negative 1, so we're going to ask ourselves again, looking right here, well, right here, at the columns again. So I'm going to say, okay, so where does negative 1 exist? Okay, well, negative 1, looking here, negative 1 is not less than negative 1, right? Okay, so it's not going to exist in this line. Negative 1 is between negative 1 and 0, okay? Because this is saying negative 1 is less than or equal to x. Okay, so negative 1 is equal to negative 1, so we're good. So this is the function that we're going to use. Okay, so we're going to say, okay, well, what is the cube root of negative 1? Right? Well, what times what times what will give you negative 1, and that would be negative 1. Lastly, we have f of 2. Okay, so again, we're going to say, well, which one of these does 2 exist on? Okay, well, 2 is not less than negative 1. Okay, so we're not going to use that one. We're going to use that one. 2 is not between negative 1 and 0, so we're going to use that one. But 2 is but greater than 0. Okay, so we're going to plug in a 2 right there in that function. So f of 2 is just simply 1 half. B, sketch the graph. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. We can make this nice and large because we don't have a better graph to paste on here. Okay, so here's what I'm doing. I'm going to color coordinate these lines. Okay, so this function is going to be in red, this function is going to be in blue, and this function is going to be in green. So 1. Okay, so 1, if I were to put little tick marks here, right? So that'd be 1. I don't think I have to go much further than 1, right? I don't think so. Okay, so these are all just one tick mark out from the origin. Okay, so 1 would be a horizontal line kind of right here. Okay, I use the line tool, so obviously I couldn't get through my tick mark perfectly. That's what that graph would look like if we did not restrict the domain. Okay, but the domain is restricted for all values that are less than negative 1. So what I'm going to have to do here is I'm going to have to draw and put an open circle there. Okay, so now I'm done with graphing the first one, again, the one in the red. Okay, now the one in the blue here is the cube root of x, and the cube root of x, if you recall, it looks kind of like an S-ish, right? Okay, well, its domain is restricted from negative 1 to 0, and we include negative 1 but not 0. Okay, so it would look something like, okay, so if this is if my parent function looks something like this, something like that, right? And if I restricted the domain, let's make it actually a little bit better. Okay, kind of, that's close enough. Okay, I want to restrict the domain from negative 1 to 0. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to erase all the values here, going to negative 1 there, and then all this all the way down to 0. Kind of like that, okay? That little sliver, okay? Well, looks like we do include negative 1, so we're going to put a close circle there at negative 1, and an open circle here at 0. Okay, and that looking good. And lastly, if you recall, the reciprocal function looked something like this, right? Well, the reciprocal function is for all values that are greater than 0. So I can really just honestly draw this part of the reciprocal function and I'd be done with it. Okay, so here we go. C, what is the domain of the graph? Okay, well, it looks like we're going all the way to negative infinity, and it looks like we're going all the way to positive infinity. Okay, but we are missing this chunk right here at 0, okay, because my middle function here does not include 0, and my third function is strictly greater than 0. Okay, so my domain, I'm going to put a little F down here. I don't know if this is the notation your text uses, but we're going to use it. The domain of F is from negative infinity to 0, unioned with 0 to infinity. Okay, and then D, what is the range? Okay, so where does this graph exist on the on the y-axis here, and also looks like we're going to be skipping 0 as well here, right? So we're going down here from negative 1 all the way to positive infinity, okay? But looks like we have that horizontal asymptote right here at 0 from the green line, and my blue one doesn't even touch 0 either, okay? So it looks like kind of the same thing. The range of F is from negative, we include negative 1. Okay, because we see that close circle there. So we have a negative 1 all the way to, all the way to 0, right? Unioned with 0 to infinity. So that was it. And I feel like the domain and range, I mean, it's just a nice, more examples of getting domains and ranges. But again, the real stickler here is sketching the graph, okay? You just sketch all three of them one at a time. All right, and lastly, we're going to find rules. Okay, so this is a good one. So now it's our job to find a rule for this function. So this function is f of x. Okay, when I mean find a rule, we're going to be doing this. We're going to be writing that like three-stage piecewise defined function. Okay, f of x is equal to, there's three graphs, so we're going to make this three there. Okay. All right, so we read the graph left to right. So we're going to start with this function here. Okay. Well, it doesn't really look like a parent function or anything at all, does it? No. It's not a constant function. It doesn't look like a parent function. How in the world do I define what that function is? Okay. Well, this is where a little bit of ingenuity and recalling things from previous sections comes into play. Okay. So notice how, let's see if I can make this bigger. This. I want to make this nice and big so we can really understand what we're looking at. Here we go. So, okay. So remember how when we defined a slope of a line, right? It was rise over run, okay? Or we could say, falling over run, right? So notice how this point here is falling 1, 2, 3 units, and it's running 1 unit. Okay, so it looks like it has a slope of -3. So let's try that again. Let's go 1, 2, 3 and over 1, and then 1, 2, 3 and over 1. Okay, so if I were to connect this line, it would look something like that. Right? So this is a line that has a slope of -3, and it has an x y-intercept at -6. Okay, how would I write a function with a slope of -3 and a y-intercept at -6? Well, we know from the slope-intercept form, well, the slope is -3, like we said, so -3x, and we have the y-intercept here at -6, and that's how we draw that. That's how we say that, okay? And then we have to define its, kind of out of room. Let's see. Right, the notes might not be pristine, but the video will be, okay? So anyways, now we have to define its domain, okay? Well, it looks like it's only existing from, right here, from -3 to right here at -2, okay? And in neither of those cases, because they're both open circles, do we actually touch -3 or -2? So we would say, maybe I can write that smaller. So we can say, that's an if. Let's try that again. If -3 is less than x is less than -2. Okay, well, that's that. We did that one. Pretty easy, okay? Next one, okay, well, whew, finally, this one looks easy, right? This is a constant function. And it looks like it's constant at 2, okay? So we will write 2, okay? And again, if, okay, so what's the domain? Looks like the domain is from a -2 to a +1, but this time we are including both -2 and +1. So we're going to say if -2 is less than or equal to x is less than or equal to 1. That was the easiest one, wasn't it? The last one, okay, well, the last one we're going to do similar to, or similar as the first one, right? Well, what is the slope? It looks like down 1 over 1. Easy. The slope is -1, okay? So we're gonna use that same thought process here, and it looks like we have the y-intercept at +2, okay? So a line with a slope of -1 and a y-intercept at +2 is written as -x + 2. Okay? And then the domain of that function would be, to my eyes, they don't really dot well, do they? They're a little bit off. That's fine. So, anyways, the domain looks like it's from 1 to infinity, but we don't include 1. So we would say if x is greater than +1, and that's it. We found the rules that define this particular piecewise defined function, and that also concludes today's lecture.